morning, good morning, good morning. Let's give God a hand clap of praise today. March the 10th, right? Lord have mercy. So we're already in the third month of the new year. Time flies, doesn't it? But God has blessed us to be here one more time. Amen. There's some folks out there, I always say this, that did not wake up, that did not make it to even be able to make it to church or just to give God praise. But I thank God for a new day. I thank God that his promises are made new every morning because God is good. His mercy and grace is just endures forever, doesn't it? We, of course, want to thank God for the return of our pastor, Marseille. He's returned safely from the Netherlands. That brother was over there running 10K. I was like, man. So I get an alert on Runkeeper, the app we use. And I was like, that brother over there getting it. You know, I'm good to run 5. His brother running. Man, shit, he's doing his thing. I'm proud of him. We're just blessed to be able to come and be in the house today. Of course, I want to mention too. We're gonna be praying a little bit. My sister Tanya is gonna be lifting up the prayer this morning, and I'm gonna throw a jab. And then my wife is traveling too, so pray for her. And then also we have another pastor. His name is Herman. So any of you know, there's a church down the street called Bethel. It used to be called Bethel Temple. It's called Bethel Church now. But there's a subsidiary ministry called Bethel International Churches, and this pastor is Pastor Herman. So a close friend of our family let us know that he coded yesterday, and he's in a hospital in ICU. Well, he got out at ICU, but he's still in the hospital. On a prayer call with him this morning. He was actually alert and actually joined in the prayer call. So I want to lift him up, Pastor Herman. So in the midst of God's goodness and grace and mercy, we know that the enemy's busy trying to discourage us. But oftentimes, you know, we go through sufferings and situations so that God can get the glory. And it's for us to grow, not necessarily for us just to go through things. Amen. But if you know, you don't grow unless you go through some things. So we're just going to give God the glory today for blessing us to be able to get here, for him answering our prayers, for us just being able to see one more day. Amen. We're thankful for this series, the sermon series from Pastor Randall these past couple Sundays. Let's give him a hand of praise. Give God praise for him. Learned a lot. I'm still having to go back through and listen to those again. There's so much in those sermons. So thank you, my brother. Some great small group studies that we did this week and discussing those different things. Amen. So y'all ready to give God praise today? Y'all ready to get into some good word? Amen. All right. You know, things are good. Things are changing. The weather is tripping, y'all. Warm one day, rainy the next, cold the next. But in the midst of that, we know that God is still the same, still consistent. Amen. So we can rest in that. We can have assurance in that. Amen. So we're just gonna continue on with our service. After we have my sister pray, and the praise and worship team will come up, and then we'll have some meet and greet, I believe, and then announcements. The song, and then we'll get to some word. Amen. So of course my daughter today will be reading the scripture too. So amen. All right, so my sister will come up and lift up a prayer. God bless you. Welcome.
You're the God of everything you are to us. You're the God who woke us up this morning. You're the God who allows us to breathe. You're the God who hung the sun this morning. You're the God who heals. You're the God who protects. You're the God who keeps us safe. You're Jehovah Jireh, our provider. When we're going through, you are Jehovah Sikkenu. You are Jehovah Nisi. You are everything to us, and we just accept that we are nothing without you. And so we invite you in right now. We thank you for your presence. Come into this place, and we welcome you, Holy Spirit, to join us in this service today. Have your way in this place. Allow us to flow with you. Allow us to be free in you. Allow your presence to just saturate this house. Let us not be the same as we came in, and let us leave different. And for our freedom, Lord God, we just humble ourselves, and we just ask that you just forgive us right now. Forgive us of our thoughts from this week, even from this morning. Forgive us of our actions that we have done or any habits that we might even have. Father, forgive us for not making the mark, Lord. Forgive us for not being obedient, Lord. And forgive us for not walking in the way that you've called us to. You are so gracious and so merciful. So we thank you, Lord God, for already being your child, that you forgave us, Lord. But we just acknowledge you in that. And Lord, we just thank you, and we thank you for the triumphs that you're going to continue to give in our lives, Lord God. We thank you for the souls that are being saved, Lord God. We thank you for this ministry, Lord God. We thank you for the pastor, Lord God, and yes, bringing him home, Lord God. We thank you for keeping his family safe while he was gone, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, for Pastor Herman, Lord God, for the praise report that though he had coded that he was awake, Lord God, and alert today, Lord God. We thank you for travel mercies for Shonda today, Lord God. We thank you for those that are on their way here, Lord God, that you keep them safe and that you protect them from any hurt, harm, or danger as they come to you. We thank you for this worship service today, Lord God. Anoint those voices on the praise team, Lord God. Willing vessels that commit to you, Lord God. We thank you as they come, Lord God, that you will bless them, but bless the congregation. Let us rise with thanksgiving and joy in our heart and praise and magnify you, Lord God. Have your way, Lord God. And we thank you for today, Lord God. And we give you all the glory and all the honor that you deserve. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Right, we're just going to lift up the name of the Lord this morning. Title of this song is Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. Amen. Amen. And we're just going to come and, you know, God has been good to us, better than we've been to ourselves. And, of course, every day that we live, we ought to just lift up the name of the Lord. He deserves the highest praise. Amen. So we're just going to give up a sacrifice of praise this morning as we go and lift up our praise and our worship. Lord, I lift your name up. On high.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. 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 Lord, I lift your name on high.
Isn't he worthy?
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Come on, I dare you to say that along with us.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Give him praise, give him glory.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
We're going to give God the honor and the praise.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
As the music fades out, we're going to give him the praise.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
God, we bless your name. We honor you.
Lord, name on high.
Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. 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 All right, next we'll have the reading of our scripture.
Genesis chapter 37, verses 14 through 24. So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring me word." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron, and he came to Shechem. Yeah, Shechem, whatever. And a man found him wandering in the fields, and the man asked him, "What are you seeking?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. Tell me, please, where they are pasturing the flock." And the man said, "They have gone away, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from afar, and before he came near to them, they conspired against him to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes the dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits, Then we will say that a fierce animal has devoured him, and we will see what will become of his dreams. But when Reuben heard it, he rescued him out of their hands, saying, "Let us not take his life." And Reuben said to them, "Shed not blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but do not lay a hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand to restore him to his father." So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the robe of many colors that he wore. And they took him and they threw him into the pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it.
Feels good to just lift up the Lord in praise, amen. It's like a weight of the week just gets lifted off. You know, we come in, there's so much stuff going on in our heads. There's times you just got to give that up. Just got to give God praise, amen. And then God blesses you as a result of that. So we're honored and blessed to just be able to have the opportunity again to lift up the name of the Lord. All right, this is our part of service where we're just going to spend some time in welcoming one another. But before we do that, I want to welcome any first-time guests that are here. If you're a first-time guest, first time, just lift your hand up. Amen. So if you're a first-time guest, you should have gotten a card, an orange card, when you came in. If you didn't get one, raise your hand up. We'll make sure you get one. All right. So please fill that out. And at the end of service, please come on up, give this to Pastor or one of us, and we'll be able to give you a gift for welcome you for coming to join us today. Amen. So God bless you. This is also a time where we have our meet and greet. We're just going to show some love, just speak a word into somebody. This is always come. It's good to come and fellowship on Sunday, just to see brothers and sisters who are in the house of God. Amen. Not nowhere in the club, but in the house of God. Even though we're right next to a club, we're praying for the people who go over there. Amen. So that they come and find their joy and their release and their satisfaction in God's house instead. Amen. So let's take about 5 minutes and let's just spend some time and meet and greet. God bless you.
Together, we are BBCC. Together we rise.
But I'll be doing the announcements and try to see. We're going to get close. All right, BVCC's Women's Ministry Paint Afternoon. It'll be on March 16th from 2 to 5, and that will be here. You can see Gwen for more info. And then we have Cup of Kindness Outreach event. That will be on March 30th from 12 to 2. Come meet our neighbors and share the light of Christ over a cup of coffee and hot cocoa. I love it. See Ade or Craig for more info. Then we have BVCC Kids Paint and Plant Workshop, March 30th at 2 p.m. See Randall for more info. Yes, I love it. Baptism. Monday, April 8th, time to be determined. It'll be at Ebenezer Baptist Church. If you are interested, please contact Pastor Randall or Marilyn Leeper. I love it. And that concludes the announcements.
Praise the Lord, church. Now, y'all know what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask y'all to stand up and join with us as we worship. Just because this is like a part of service where we can all participate. Amen. So if you are physically able, I'm just going to ask you to stand and join in with us as we sing this song. It's called Thy Will. And, you know, a lot of times we go through stuff. We don't understand why God does what he does. It's not for us to necessarily understand. We can ask why. But at the end of the day, we need God's will to be done. And that's what we're going to trust in and stand firmly in. So, again, just join with us as we minister this song this morning.
I'm so confused. I know I heard you loud and clear. So I follow through. Somehow I ended up here. I don't wanna think, I may never understand how my broken heart is a part of your plan. When I try to pray, all I've got is hurt and these four words. Feel good right now, and I know you think of things I could never think about.
It's hard to count it all joy, distracted by the noise, just trying to make sense of all your promises. Sometimes I gotta stop, remember that you're God, and I am not so.
Thy will be done. Thy will be done. Thy will be
done. Like a child on my knees, all that comes to me is
Thy will. I
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Mm.
Thank you, Lord.
Good morning, y'all. It is good to be back. I have missed my church family. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you so much for your prayers during my trip. I was gone for a couple of weeks, but it's good to be home, y'all. It is so good to be back. It's so good to see my church family. Really quickly, I want to shout out my main man, Pastor Randall, for holding down the fort, preaching for the past couple of weeks. I was checking them out online and just missing y'all, but it was a good word. I know y'all were blessed by the series, just being able to take in, the different teachings and principles, and it was just such a blessing. So I want to just love on him and appreciate all of y'all just for being who you are. But we're going to get ready to get into the word this morning. I think we do have children's church today. I'm out of the routine, so y'all bear with me. But the kids, we're going to have, let them be dismissed. We're going to have our elementary and middle school kids will be in the back today for children's church. And the rest of y'all stuck with me. Is that okay? So I haven't preached in a couple of weeks, so we only going to be here for about 3-4 hours. Nah, look, I'm just messing. All our first-time guests, let me see y'all out of here. See y'all later. Getting my coat. Let me just see my way out. But now we are starting a new series today, y'all, a new series. And the name of this series is called It Still Hurts. It Still Hurts. And we're going to be dealing with some of the things that we go through, that we have been through, right? Some of the trauma we have faced. Some of the trickery we have faced by other people. And some of the tragedies. And we're going to talk all about how do we walk in the healing that God wants us to be a part of. How does God put the broken pieces back together? But before we get started, I want to have a word of prayer. If that's all right with y'all, we're going to pray real quickly before we open up today's message. God, thank you so much for the privilege of being with your people. Thank you for the first-time guests, God. Thank you for those who are returning. Thank you for everybody who's here, God, because they're supposed to be. God, we thank you, Father God, for what you are speaking, what you are doing. And God, we just bless you this morning. We look forward, God, to what you're going to say. And God, I pray that you would allow us to be open and receptive to the word of God. I pray, Lord God, that we would not just be hearers of the word, but doers of what it says, God. And I pray this morning, God, for the person that's dealing with trauma, because it still hurts. We may look like it's all okay on the outside, but the truth of the matter is that it still hurts. We may be smiling, God, but it still hurts. So my prayer this morning, God, is that we would experience the healing power of the true and living God, that we would have a testimony that people would look at us and say, man, that God is real. Father, allow me to decrease so that you would increase and get all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, I chuckled on my way in this morning because Danielle, she saw the title and she said, Pastor, this morning you must have chosen violence. She said, you chose violence and you really are going in today. But the Lord had impressed in my heart that we are going through some stuff. Right, we are going through some stuff, and I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but the fact of the matter is we are all going through some things, and I don't know about y'all, but my kids, when they were younger, they would fall down, cry, scream, snot bubble, and all that kind of stuff, but 3 minutes later, they were playing like nothing ever happened. But as I've gotten older in this life, if I sleep funny, if I turn to the wrong side, for days and sometimes even months, it still hurts. But in life, there are people that we have lost, right? There are people who have left us, right? There are folks who have let us down. We've experienced trauma in our lives. We've experienced tragedy. People have tricked us. They've lied to us. They've let us down. And we still go to work. We still show up to church. But the fact of the matter is that it still hurts. And the thing is that when we don't process these things, we may look fine on the outside, but it still hurts. And we are all going through the stuff of life, and sometimes it still hurts. But we're going to study in the course of this series the life of Joseph. And we know Joseph to be the dreamer, right?
But Joseph went through a whole lot of stuff. But God used the stuff in his life to do something powerful, to not just bless Joseph, but to bless a whole nation. And when it's all said and done, we make our way through this series, right? God's going to do some things in our lives to build us up so that we can build a testimony and impact our city. So I want to give you my bottom line as we open up this series. The bottom line is that God can use your trauma to build a testimony that's worth talking about. And let me say that again. God can use your trauma to build a testimony that's worth talking about. Let's read the scriptures here in the book of Genesis, and we're going to start talking about Joseph throughout the next several weeks. Now, just to let you know, we are going to take a bit of a pause because Resurrection Sunday is coming up at the end of the month. Shauna's going to be preaching as well on Palm Sunday. And then I'm going to come and preach on Resurrection Sunday, and then we're going to jump right back to our series. So we're going to start, and then we're going to park for a minute, and then we're going to come right back. Is that okay? All right, so let's look at what the text says here in Genesis 37. It says, so he said to him, go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring me word. This is Joseph's father talking. So he sent him from the valley of Hebron, and he came to Shechem. And a man found him wandering in the fields. And the man asked him, what are you seeking? I'm seeking my brothers, he said. Tell me, please, where they are pasturing the flock. And the man said, they have gone away, for I heard them say, let's go to Dothan. So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from afar, and before he came near to them, they conspired against him to do what? To kill him. See, you thought your family had drama. See, you thought they had your sister and your cousin and them had issues. It says, and they said to one another, here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us celebrate his dream. Let's support him and encourage him along the way. He says, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we will say that a fierce animal has devoured him, and we will see what will become of his dreams. You thought your brother and sister didn't like you, right? You thought that they were giving you a hard time. Here, Joseph's brothers literally want to kill him. But when Reuben, who was the oldest, heard it, he rescued him out of their hands, saying, let us not take his life. And Reuben said to them, shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but do not lay a hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand and restore him to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the robe of many colors that he wore. And they took him and threw him into a pit. The pit was empty, and there was no water in it. See, Joseph just went through trauma. So Joseph went from the favorite son. He goes from the favorite son, and the scripture tells us that his father Israel, loved Joseph the most because Joseph was his son born in his old age. Now, parents, I know your kids are in the back, but I don't want you all to raise your hands about which one is your favorite kid. Many parents have a favorite child, believe it or not, and I don't want anybody to raise their hands, okay? But here, Joseph's dad, his favorite son was Joseph, and he buys him this coat of many colors, this Versace coat of many colors. I mean, this guy drip is looking good, right? And he gives his son this coat. And Joseph, his spiritual gift was prophecy, right? His spiritual gift was prophecy. So Joseph has a dream, and in his dream, he talks about your sheep is going to bow down to mine, and he gives all of these interpretations, and his brothers are like, oh, you got a dream. You're the youngest, and you're going to rule over us? We're going to be your servants? So his brothers don't celebrate his dream. And then on top of it, His dad says, look, I want you to go out and check on these guys, because the fact of the matter is he really didn't trust them, right? He knew what he was working with. His sons are out there shepherding the flock. So he sends them to go check. But Joseph was the favorite son. And in a moment, in an instant, he goes from the favorite son to a forgotten slave. So his brothers, they see him coming, right? And they say, we're going to see what happens to him in his dream. We're going to see about his little business plan. We're going to see about his little college that he want to go to, right? We're going to see about his little vision board, right, and his little coat. We're going to take him, and we're going to kill him. But his oldest brother said, no, don't kill him. Let's just throw him in the pit. So they throw him in the pit, and then some traitors come by, and Joseph gets sold. But here's the thing. Joseph was betrayed by his own family, right? He's mocked, right? They said, we're going to take this coat off of him. Right, we'll see what happens to you in your dream. They throw him in a pit, and he is abandoned. Can you imagine? And if you read the rest of this verse, the very next verse, we didn't read it. It says they had him in the pit, and they sat down to eat. I mean, come on. You got me laying in this pit. No water in it. I'm over here fearing for my life, and you eating chicken wings. Right? I mean, can you imagine? They out there having a party, and Joseph is down in the pit. So he goes from the favorite son to a forgotten slave. And on top of that, his own father, the one who was his favorite, he just took their word for it. Can you imagine the thoughts in his mind? Nobody's looking for me. They say one of the worst things about being lost is when they stop looking. So Joseph goes through this traumatic experience. And I don't know, you know, as I read the Bible, I think Joseph has got to be top three of the most traumatic, going through the most traumatic lives in the Bible. I mean, Job's got put him in running for the money. But Joseph goes through trauma. He goes through trauma. And the thing about it, we're going to see from his life, he goes through all of this, but he comes out on top. And God uses the trauma to build a testimony that's worth talking about. But so many of us are walking around and it still hurts, because we haven't processed the trauma. So let's talk really quickly, really briefly. What is trauma? What is trauma? So on your paper, you got the definitions. Don't try to squint your eyes and see this. But trauma is an emotional response to an event or a series of events that are deeply distressing, stressful, frightening, or threaten or cause physical or emotional harm to you or someone else. That's how we're going to define trauma. Now, as I was studying this, I saw something that says 2 of 3 children by the age of 16 have had a traumatic experience. That's just kids. They've had at least one traumatic experience. And if I were to poll us this morning, probably all of us have had some sort of traumatic experience in our lives. Right? And the thing about it is that trauma, it introduces stress when you come around something close, right? It gives you anxiety. You may develop a phobia of fear. You may fall into depression. That trauma has an impact on your life. Why? Because it still hurts. It still hurts. And as we look at it, every one of us has our own ways of dealing with trauma. You may diagnose trauma as being a near-death experience. But trauma could be emotional abuse. Trauma could be abandonment. Trauma could be what your parents did or didn't do. Trauma comes in all shapes, forms, and fashions. Some of us have experienced trauma in the church, but it still hurts. But how do we deal with our trauma? Here's how most of us deal with our trauma. First of all, many of us isolate ourselves when we are dealing with trauma. We don't share it. We isolate ourselves, and nobody really knows what's going on with us, because we have distanced ourselves from everybody else, right? They don't know the pain I feel. They don't know the hurt that I feel. They have no idea what I'm going through. And as I like to say here, we like to suffer in silence. See, we isolate ourselves when we are dealing with trauma. But on top of that, sometimes we ignore the trauma. We bury our head in the sand, and we deny the fact that we have had traumatic experiences. We deny the fact that it still hurts. We bury our head in the sand, and we try to ignore it and hope that it goes away. Maybe if I just forget about it, it'll stop hurting. I'll just act like everything is okay. How you doing, bro? I'm fine. I'm blessed and highly favored. But nobody knows that it still hurts. Some of us decide to medicate our trauma. We think we can drink it away. We think we can smoke it away. Some of us think we can eat it away, right? And we do all of these things to deal with the trauma. But then some of us explode. We explode. And what do you mean, Pastor? I'm going through trauma, and I'm taking out my frustrations and my pain on everyone else who's around me. And I lose it on people. And my kids come in, and it's their fault. And we explode on them. And the thing about it is we actually cause them to go through more trauma. See, we ought to be passing down generational blessings, but many of us are just translating our trauma and projecting it onto somebody else. So we ought to have a legacy of building up, but our trauma causes us to tear down. See, that's how many of us deal with our trauma. But the problem is that only makes it worse. That only makes it worse. You see, this picture really spoke to me because you see here, if you look at it, he's putting his hand in the crack in the wall trying to stop the leak, only to realize that all of that is just flowing through him and spilling out on the floor. You see, if you were going through kidney failure or something like that, you may be on the line for what they call a donor list to get a transplant, right? To get a kidney transplant, a heart transplant, lungs, whatever those things are, right? And sometimes you get that transplant, but in some cases, after the transplant, the body will actually reject it. The thing that was supposed to help gets rejected, and then key organs start to shut down. Pastor, what are you talking about? What I'm talking about is this. Sometimes we try to transplant medication into our lives, only to find that the thing that we try to get help from starts to be rejected, and our peace starts to shut down. See, if you understood what I was talking about, you would realize that the thing that you are trying to put in place of your trauma that was supposed to help is now causing hurt, and there are key parts of your life, your marriage, your mindset, all of these things are starting to shut down that were intended to originally help you. See, you got to realize that if you don't do it God's way, it's only going to make it worse. And so many of us are transplanting the wrong things. And those things that we thought were helping us are just starting to shut down. So what's the right way? Pastor, what's the right way? Let me help you for a minute. Because if it still hurts, we've got to get to the place where we realize that God's got a better way. And the thing is, the right way is this. First of all, there's got to be awareness of the trauma that you went through. Right? Awareness of the fact that you went through emotional trauma, the awareness of the fact that, the things that you are struggling with, it actually happened. But then you've got to acknowledge it, right? Number one, I realize I've gone through some trauma in my life. But then I have an awareness of this thing is real, right? I'm taking ownership of this, right? Realizing that, yes, I have gone through trauma and trauma is here in my life and it still hurts. But then the last thing is that we've got to take some action. We got to take some action because if we never take action, it's still going to hurt. So here's the thing I want you to do. I want you to, first of all, learn how to process your emotions. Process your emotions. We were created to be emotional beings, to express what's going on with us and in us. And if we don't process that, just like the picture, all of that flows through us and it comes out at the worst possible time. Process your emotions. But on top of that, we've got to experience biblical community. And the last thing I want you to understand is you've got to experience God's healing. Three main steps. Process your emotions, experience biblical community, and experience God's healing. Let's unpack that for a minute, if that's okay. See, if it still hurts, I want to show you how to get it better, right? And the thing about this is this. We've got to learn how to process our emotions. You see, a traumatic experience is a major loss that never leaves you. What do you mean, Pastor? It's always going to be there to some degree. But it's about how do we learn how to process it to work towards healing. See, I've learned this. It's okay to question God. Y'all like, wait, what? I'm going to show you scripturally here in a second. It's okay to question God. And we've got to learn how to grieve over the losses in our lives, to cry about some things, to write some things down, to journal some things, and really get to the place where we are grieving the loss that we that happened to us. Because so often we are ignoring it, we're packing it all away, but we are struggling. We are hurting. We are bleeding all over the place. It's okay to have Jesus and a therapist. Don't bottle your emotions because God, he sees every tear. He knows your pain, and he wants to hear all about it. See, what is, here's the thing, right? I told you it's okay to question God. And some of y'all who don't read the Bible and just grow up in church, you listen to what Auntie so-and-so said who don't read the Bible, right? But here's what David did. David says this in Psalms 13. He says, how long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all day? How long shall my enemy be exalted before me? See, the thing is, you got two verses, and David's questioned God five times. See, the thing is, don't talk about God behind his back. Say it to his face. I mean, let's keep it a buck for a second. I mean, if you're going to talk about me behind my back, why don't you come and bring it to my face? And here you got David, who's bold enough to say, God, how long am I going to stay in this mess? And the thing for you and I, if we learn how to process our emotions before God, it's okay to say, God, why did my spouse cheat on me? Why did you allow my dad to have a child with another woman outside of wedlock? Why did you let me go through this abuse, God? Why did my mom have to be addicted to drugs? Why? But so often we talk about God behind his back, but we never come talk to him to his face. See, the thing about it is when we realize these emotions, these raw, real emotions, and we give them to God and we bring them right to him, God starts to heal us, and he starts to move in our lives and starts to show us aspects of himself that we never knew before. And the thing about it is you can't grieve on your own and self-medicate on your own and isolate on your own and go through all of these things on your own, because these are burdens that you were never designed to bear. And you do not have the capacity or the capability to process them by yourself. So the first thing is you got to process these emotions. But the next thing is you got to experience biblical community. And the thing I want you to learn how to do today is to upgrade your team. Upgrade your team. And here's what I want you to grab hold of. You got to get around some people who are not news reporters. You need to upgrade your team to get some first responders. You see, let me tell you the difference. Because the reporter just shows up for the story. The reporter just shows up because they want to be the first one to report out. And so many of us, when we are going through stuff, there are people who show up just to take a picture, just to post it online, just to call and say, girl, you ain't going to believe that Marseille's going through this. You ain't going to believe what he's struggling with in his life. See, they just want to report. But a first responder shows up to render aid. The first responder shows up, they're going to give some CPR. The first responder is going to give you a blood transfusion. They're going to show up on the scene because they care about helping put you back in order more so than just getting a story. See, we've got to learn how to upgrade our team. See, I don't know about you, but I like what Ecclesiastes says. It says two are better than one. It says because they have a good reward for their toil. It says, for if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. It says, but woe to him who is alone, isolation, when he falls and has not another to lift him up. See, I don't know about you, but I need some people on my team who will intercede until God intervenes. I don't know about you, but I need some people on my team who will show up at 3 a.m. when I'm going through. I don't know about you, but I need some people who will show up and go with me to the counseling appointment on my team. I need somebody who can look at me and say, when I say I'm fine, they'll look at me and say, no, you're not. Right? They'll look at me and say, look, I know you're going through something. I can tell because I know you. Right? I need some people on my team who are not just going to let me walk around suffering in silence, but are going to say, look, bro, we got you through this process. See, that church is biblical community. And that is what God is calling us towards. He's not calling us to look like we got it all together, but to be going through some stuff and realize that we are not by ourselves. We always say, whether we rise or whether we fall, we do it together. But biblical community goes that step further and says, when you hurt, I hurt. When you're struggling, I'm struggling, right? And realizing that, you know what, sometimes it's going to be ugly. Sometimes it's going to be difficult. But the fact of the matter is, we are together. That's biblical community. We can't just go to this place of it's still hurting, but God wants us to take action. And the last thing I want you to do is to experience God's healing. Experience his presence, experience his healing. Because here's the thing. I've learned that God can use trauma to make you stronger. Pastor, what do you mean? You see, Shauna is a certified personal trainer. And if you ever show up to one of her sessions, you're going to leave sore, right? And the thing about it is she's going to stretch you. She's going to push you, right? You're going to go through things, and you are going to be sore. The thing about the soreness, the way that muscles grow is they are injured, right? The muscles actually tear a little bit, right? They tear, and then they heal. And the thing about it is when they tear and they heal, that's how they get bigger, and that's how they get stronger. But the thing about it is that so many of us give up because we're a little bit sore. So many of us give up because it's a little bit uncomfortable. It's a little bit difficult. And the thing is, you understand that you are now growing, right? You understand that you are growing not because you don't have problems. You understand that you are growing because your problems don't have you. And just because you've been through some soreness, that is a part of your growth. Because you've been through some difficulty, that is a part of your process. And we so often want life to be easy. We so often want life not to be hard, but we will never grow without this difficulty. We will never grow without this tearing of our muscles, of our faith, and without this healing process, that stretching, that pulling, that growing, that's what allows us to grow. But the thing about it, too many of us. This is why the gym loves y'all when you show up in January. Because the gym says, oh, they're going to show up and they're going to pay me for a whole year and they're never going to come back again. And you know what? My equipment is going to be just fine. But so many of us make the mistake of we stop showing up because we're a little bit sore. We stop showing up to small group because we're a little bit sore. Because you got a message on Sunday when Pastor Randall preached, they might have stepped on your toes, you didn't come back the next week. But get to the point where you understand that I need that. I need that because that's what's going to help me to grow. See, the thing about working out is that you got to fight through the soreness. And here's what I've learned. When I was in college playing football, we would go through a game on Saturday. And I would wake up on Sunday morning, and I felt like I had been in a car accident. Right? I mean, everything sore. My teeth were sore. Right, my hair was sore. But what they did was they made us go to the weight room the next day and lift weights again. And the thing about it was after I lifted weights, after I ran a little bit, I could keep on going. And you and I have got to understand something. We've got to keep on showing up. Even though you're a little bit sore, even though you're a little bit frustrated, even though you're wondering, do they really love me? Are they really the people they say they are? Keep on showing up. Because when you're going to get around some Jesus in that process, and that's going to help you to grow. Don't stop showing up. Keep on coming. And the thing about Joseph in his life, we're going to unpack this, but understand something. Joseph got thrown in that pit. He kept on coming. See, he got out of that pit and he got sold. And when he got sold, guess what? He got betrayed, but he kept on coming. And then he got thrown into the prison. People forgot about him, but he kept on coming. And no matter how hard it is, no matter how difficult it is, no matter how you feel, my word for you today is you got to keep on coming. No matter how sore, no matter how frustrated, no matter how down you feel, just keep coming. God, I'm here, and I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say, but God, I'm here. I'm showing back up, and you will understand something. God will show you some things that you couldn't see before, because the thing about it is this. Y'all ever lost your keys before? How many of y'all settle for that? I mean, it's like, well, I guess I ain't got no car no more. I ain't going nowhere. I lost my keys, right? This is just how life is. See, when I lost something, when I lose my keys, I go on a hunt. I go on a hunt. I mean, I'm looking in places I haven't been in years. I mean, for real. Like, I was getting ready for my trip to go to the Netherlands, and I was looking for one thing, and I'm like, I haven't been here in 6 months. And I'm looking for the thing in a place I haven't been. But here's the thing. In my search, I found other stuff. I found stuff my wife was missing, right? I came to her and said, hey, babe, you remember you were looking for that thing? Here it is, right? Right? The thing about it is in your search, in your looking, you will find things about God and discover things about God that you never knew. You will discover peace. You will discover revelation that you never would have discovered before. You see, we've got to see God in a new way in our search for him. But here's the thing. Y'all see this picture up here? Those two people are not related by blood, if you know, right? But here's what happened in their story. So this grandmother here, she sends a text thinking it was her grandson. And she sent it to the wrong person. But he responded to the text. Let me read it to you. It says, Thanksgiving dinner's in my house, blah, 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 right? And he says, who is this? And she says, it's your grandma. And he was like, grandma, can you send a picture? So she sends a picture. Here's what happens. He says, you're not my grandma, but can I come anyway? So my man shows up for Thanksgiving. And guess what? 8 years later, they still celebrate Thanksgiving together. But here's what you got to grab hold of. See, when you are looking at God differently in the midst of your trauma, see, she went through some trauma because during COVID, her husband died due to the pandemic. He contracted COVID and died. But through that process, her family grew to this young man. And then he brought his girlfriend. And now guess what? He calls her grandma. And now they're family. See, you got to understand something. In the process of your trauma and you looking for God, you can see new things that you never saw before. You can experience God in ways you never experienced him before. Trauma can be so confusing for us to navigate, but we've got to see the bigger picture. Last thing I want to give you is this. I'm going to give you this and I'm going to sit down. I want you to let God handle your trauma. Let God handle and heal your trauma. I'm going to give you this story, and I'm done. I'm sitting down. Last thing I want to leave with you is the story of Elizabeth Elliot. Elizabeth Elliot. So Elizabeth was a missionary back in the 50s who traveled to Ecuador down in South America to be a missionary. Her and her husband went down to Ecuador to be missionaries. And they go to this tribe, and her husband, along with five other missionaries, is killed. He's murdered by the tribe they are trying to minister to. So their mission was to go down there and evangelize for Jesus. Now Elizabeth's got a 10-month-old daughter. She's a widow. She's gone through trauma. But she goes back, and she's praying to God, and really, God, what am I supposed to do? God leads her to go back to the same tribe, minister to the same people. So she goes back, ministers to this tribe without her husband, who is now dead. Her daughter is raised in the same tribe, and the tribe comes to know Jesus. And in this process, she has lost some things. In this process, I don't know what's going on with my mic. In this process, she has lost some things. She is going through trauma in this whole process. All right, Craig, I'm going to tell you, this is not you. This is user error. She goes through this process. Her husband has died. Most of us would have went through that, and we ain't never going back. But you've got to understand that God used her trauma for something so much bigger. God used the trauma that she went through for something so much bigger. And she started to minister to these people, and they became her family. And the thing is, most of us, we're looking for a spear to get them. But her mission and her purpose was that God's greater purpose would come to pass. If she would have suffered in her silence, those people would have never known Jesus. If she would have suffered, if she would have self-medicated, they would have never come to know Christ. If she would have isolated herself, if she would have just allowed herself to explode and go off on everybody that she was around, no one else would have experienced this benefit. Joseph, in his trauma, he didn't have a counselor, but he had the wonderful counselor. He had the Prince of Peace. Joseph, in his trauma, he wasn't surrounded by biblical community. But the thing Joseph had was that he had his eyes fixed on God. And God healed his trauma. And the thing about it is that Joseph looked at the same people that betrayed him, and he said, you know what you meant for evil, when you killed my dream, when you threw me in that pit, God used it for my good. And the trauma that you faced in your life, the people who left you, those who let you down, what you lost, all of these things, God wants to use it for your good. He wants to turn your trauma into a testimony that's worth talking about. See, we talk about Joseph's story, his trauma. We don't talk about his trauma. We talk about his story, his testimony. It's worth talking about. And you may find yourself here today saying, Pastor, it still hurts. But I want you to know right here, right now, we're going to go ahead and stop right here. Every head bowed, every eye closed. You may be looking at where you are, your space, your trauma, your pain, your struggle, the thing you're going through. Pastor, you don't know what I'm going through. You're right, I don't, but God does. And I guarantee you one thing. There's nothing that you've gone through that God is not equipped to handle. And maybe you've been talking about God behind his back, and today you're saying, you know what, I need to talk to him to his face. You know what, Pastor, if I were to be honest with you, it still hurts. And I have felt for the longest time alone. I have felt for the longest time frustrated. I felt for the longest time upset. But today, I need some prayer, and it still hurts. Maybe you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. The very first thing that we want to do is make sure you have a relationship with him. See, we talked about organ donors, and we talked about bodies rejecting, but there is one who is the universal donor. His blood is compatible with every type of sin. His love never runs out. Maybe you've been battling and you're like, why would God ever allow me to go through that thing in the first place? Sometimes he allows you to go through it so he can show you things about himself, but also so you can go and help other people. Maybe you don't know this Jesus as your Lord and Savior, but you want to. Maybe you found yourself drifting from him and your relationship is not where it used to be. You stopped putting him first a while ago. But today you want to make a declaration to recommit yourself to Jesus. If you want to know him as your Lord and Savior, or if you want to reconnect, I want you to just slip your hand out right where you are. If you're saying, Pastor, I need Jesus, just slip your hand out right where you are, because I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you that God will begin to restore and reconnect you. And I want you to say these words after me. Just say this with me. Say, Lord, I'm a sinner, and I need Jesus. Say this with me. Say, I've messed up. I've made mistakes. But I believe you died for me. I believe you took my place. You hung on that cross. You laid in that grave. but I believe you rose from the dead. Say this with me. Say, come into my heart. Wash me clean. Live on the inside and help me to live for you. And then say this with me. Say, I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. If you prayed that prayer to accept Jesus, or you prayed that prayer to reconnect and recommit, I want you to see me at the end of service, because I want to get some resources in your hand. I want to talk to you for a minute. I want to help you to be successful in that area of your life. But then my next prayer, my next invitation is for the person who's saying, Pastor, you know what? It still hurts. I'm going through some stuff right here that nobody knows about. I feel the effects of my trauma. I am in the pit of despair. I am in the pit of anger. I'm in the pit of feeling alone. It still hurts. And I need some prayer today, because I've been trying to deal with this thing on my own, but I can't. If you're saying, Pastor, would you pray for me? I want you to just briefly make your way up to the altar, because we want to pray with you this morning. Folks are coming up today to get in position to pray for you, and there's room. There's room. Even if it still hurts, there's room. And my commitment to you is that I'm not going to be the reporter just showing up to get the story, just showing up to gossip about you. Our commitment today is that we want to be first responders. We're not going to let you bleed out. We're not going to let you have a heart attack and suffer alone. These first responders are here to pray with you and to pray for you. If that's you, I want you to make your way down to this altar, because we're going to pray encouragement over your life. We're going to pray strength over your life. We're going to pray healing. As we begin to pray at the altar, the Lord's still dealing with you. I want you to make your way. If it still hurts, we want to begin that process of working through healing, working through biblical community, working through restoration, working through encouragement. That's what we are called to do as the church. God's going to use your trauma to build a testimony that's worth talking about. As we begin to pray, there's still room. There's still room. As the Lord is dealing with you, there is still room. Thank you. now, Father, we thank you for this time of your word. We thank you, God, for how you're pouring out your spirit in this place. Father, our belief, our petition, our prayer is that this word, God, is helping somebody. This is not our word. It's not our idea. It's yours. So we pray that you would allow it to do the thing that you intended it to do. And I pray, Father, that as we leave this place, as we exit this time of preaching, that word is sealed in our spirit. I pray, Father, that it's getting better and better and better. And God, help us to realize, Lord, our lives, a good life is not the absence of problems, but it's keeping our hand in your hand and seeing you as our deliverer. As Tanya prayed earlier, seeing you as our righteousness, seeing you as our provider, seeing you as our banner, seeing you as our protector. God, seeing you. So we thank you for the experience of knowing you. And I pray, Father, that we are never the same. God, we bless you, we honor you, and we give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Y'all, let's give God a hand clap of praise. This morning. Amen. Amen. Anybody get anything out of the message today? Amen. We are going to be digging in, so make sure you show up to small group, because we are going to be really unpacking this thing. We're probably going to be talking about trauma next week again, because I couldn't finish it all in one week. But we'll see what happens next week as the Lord unwraps this thing. But we want to talk real quickly about next steps. You know, as you've heard this message, you've been here for a while. Maybe this is your first Sunday, your second, maybe your fifth, right? And maybe the Lord is calling you to connect to this as your church home. You know, I would love to be your pastor. We would love to be your church family. And if God is calling you to connect, to say, you know what, I need to plant my flag here. I need to be covered. I need to be surrounded by some people who are going to help me to climb in life and not cause me to crawl through life. Right, if that's you, I want you to grab that card in front of you. It's got a QR code. Just scan it. It says, I'm ready to connect. I want to become a member of this church. I want to be a disciple. Right, and we're going to help plug you into those next steps so you can walk along this process of spiritual growth. If you do sign that or you do fill that out, please see me as well, because I got some resources that I want to get into your hand. But maybe today you didn't come up here for prayer this morning, but you're saying, I need some prayer. You know, Pastor, I'm not the kind of person that goes into the altar and have people touching me and putting their hands on me. But you know what? I still need some prayer. I want you to grab that card, fill it out, because we have a team of prayer warriors who pray continuously on our behalf. I ask them to pray for me all the time, right? And you can ask that same request. So if you have a prayer request, make sure you fill that out. Also, we've got volunteer opportunities. And if you're saying, I want God to be able to use my hands and my feet to serve and bless other people, there's a lot of great things going on here at this church as we are trying to be the hands and feet of Jesus in our community. And if you want to become a volunteer, you want to serve, I want you to grab that QR code and fill that out as well, because we want to get you plugged in, because part of our process is to serve other people, right? We are not blessed just to be blessed. We are blessed to be a blessing. Right, we are healed to help somebody else heal. So if that's you, I want you to fill that out as well. But then we want to talk briefly about giving. Right, so here at BVCC, we really don't tell people what to give. We tell you how to give, right? And that giving is, first of all, is an act of worship. And when we worship God, right, we're supposed to give him our first and our best, right? And in that giving, it's an act of worship. We lift our hands, we open our mouths, but also God calls us to look into our financial blessings and to bless his kingdom, right? So for us, we want to encourage you to give God your best gift. And up here is the information you can give on the screen. There's also a box in the back if you are giving through the envelopes. But we want to encourage you to give sacrificially and to give cheerfully. Two criteria. Give sacrificially and give cheerfully. Somewhere in the scriptures it says, I will not give to the Lord that which costs me nothing. In other words, it's got to be a sacrifice. And that sacrifice means that I'm going to give God from my first fruits. I'm going to give him from my absolute best, because he is the one. If God stops blessing my life, I don't know about you, but I'm afraid to live my life outside of God's covering. He's taking me too far out there. And if he walks away, oh, it's going to be bad. And I want you to understand something. You cannot outgive God. See, God gives us a seed. And that seed may leave your hand, but guess what? It will never leave your life. So I want to encourage you to give God your first gift. It is an act of worship. When we give God, when you give your seed, God, I'm worshiping you in this. I'm sacrificing because I want you to be blessed. I want somebody else to be able to eat. I want somebody else's lights to be kept on. I want somebody else to see the glory of God through my giving. That's giving in worship. That's giving cheerfully. That's giving sacrificially. So thank you in advance for your giving. And we are believing God to do great things as you pour into his kingdom. With that being said, we're going to get ready to have the benediction. And we're going to be dismissed. So I'm still operating off a six-hour time difference. So I'm just praising God that I didn't fall asleep during the message. If you did, that's on you, right? You didn't go to bed last night. But understand something. God is moving in this place, and we are so excited. I want to encourage you to go to small group this week. Baptism, I do want to touch on that really quickly. So we're going to have another baptism April the 8th, so right after Resurrection Sunday. So if you just came to know Jesus, if you just joined the church, you have kids that want to be baptized, we are going to take you through a class. Right? So you understand what baptism is and what it's not. But we want to celebrate what God is doing. God is making disciples. God is saving souls. God is changing lives. So it's going to be a celebration. It's going to be a party. Make sure you sign up for it. See Randall, see Marilyn, but it is coming up soon. With that being said, we're going to get out of here. Y'all ready to go? Yeah. All right. I got a half and half. So if you don't want to go, you can stay. And somebody going to preach other than me. But let's look to the Lord to be dismissed. Thank you, Father, so much for today's service, today's worship. Thank you for being able to sing your praises. Thank you for being able to love on one another, to hug on one another. Thank you for the kids in the back, Lord God, for our resources to be able to bless them. God, we thank you, Father God, just for your faithfulness and goodness. I pray, Lord God, that you would be glorified as we get ready to depart. And as we leave this place, I pray we would never leave your presence. Make your face shine upon us and give us your everlasting, eternal peace. Allow others to see you in us. And God, we pray when it's all said and done, our lives are a living testimony, a living testament of the changing power of Jesus. Lord, let us be your salt and light in this dark world so that men would know that Jesus is Lord. Father, we bless you, we honor you, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. That concludes today's service. First time guests, please see me. Don't rush off. I got a gift I want to give you. And have a great week.